like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Oh, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never. I'll worship your holy name. Lord, I'll worship your holy name.
Lord, I confess, Thou in here I find my rest. Without You, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need You.
Where sin runs deep, Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where You are. Where You are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need You. Oh, teach my song to rise to You. When temptations come my way, when I cannot stand or fall on You, Jesus, You're my hope and stay. My hope and stay.
Pray that, we sing that. I've been reminded so many times this year, where would I go but to You, God? Lord, I need You. We need You in our daily life. We need You at school. We need You at work. We need You at home. We need You wherever we're at. God, help us to recognize that. Help us to rely on You, to lean into You, to have that be a place that we go back to again and again. God, be my comfort, my peace. We need you. Thank you that you invite us to that. You delight in us coming and relying on your strength and not our own. And we pray this because of Christ in his powerful name. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. As Nathan has said, welcome to you, those of you who are here, those of you who are watching online. This has been a service we've been looking forward to for some time, and we'll tell you about it in just a moment. I want to let the kids know, if you want to dismiss now to go to kids' church, you're welcome to do that. So you can make your way down to the back. Just quickly, two other announcements. Small groups, as part of our kind of response to some of the situations of our world right now, it's more than ever reminding us of how important it is to have a small group connection. It's different here in the room. It's different with all kinds of situations, but to be involved with a smaller group. We did small group in my group probably for 2 months on Zoom calls, which is kind of different. Then we started meeting in backyards and spread apart and that sort of thing. And to have that kind of connection is just so important, especially right now. So we actually have 6 new small groups starting in the next week or so. If you haven't found out about that and you're interested, there's some brochures in your bulletins. You can see them at the back. But small groups are kind of surging forward right now in a pretty cool way, so you can take part of that. Also, I just want to remind you, if you do not normally get emails from us as a church, whether you're here or online, please let us know if you'd like to, because that's such an important way we communicate, especially now. We're not sure what's happening week to week in our society kind of thing, so it's nice to have emails for us to be able to communicate with you if there's last-minute changes and that sort of thing. So if you don't normally get them, just call the church office or email office@bb.church and let us know what your email address is. If you'd like to be part of that list, we'd love to be able to do that. But glad you're here. Jerry and Luella, you're freaking me out. Because for 3 years, you sat over there. And for the last 6 months, you sat there. And now you're across the aisle, and I don't know what's happening. I don't know if you're headed for the parking lot or what's going on, but it's kind of messing me up just a little bit. But I'm glad you're here anyway. Hey, we've been talking about and are planning about this thing called Faith in Blue Sunday. And am I supposed to do something else here? Why are you still here?
You told me to stay up here.
No, you guys can go now. You have no purpose to be here. I mean, stay in the room, but I don't understand that at all. Come to the meetings. Read the memos, if you wouldn't mind. So. In our planning, we've been calling this Faith in Blue Sunday. And Faith in Blue is a national initiative that's launching in churches across our country this very weekend. And its purpose is to build bridges between law enforcement agencies and the communities that they serve. And unless you live in a bubble, you're probably aware that the trust between law enforcement and the public in general has been complicated, especially in certain parts of the country. Controversies have been brewing. And it's become yet another issue we have to look at, about which people disagree and debate and are polarized. So in the Bismarck-Mandan area, we have something a little bit different, I think. There are all kinds of differing opinions, but there is, by and large, very strong support here for law enforcement. But that unity is being tested at times. That support, we can't assume it's always going to be there. So when Faith in Blue initiative came across our chief of police desk a month or two ago, it led to discussions between him and Burley County Sheriff Kelly Lieben and Chaplain Greg Carr and myself, and we felt it would be helpful to have representatives of law enforcement and police and sheriff agencies stand in front of a variety of congregations over the next number of weeks to strengthen understanding, to build connections and build bridges. And I offered our churches to be the first place to talk about Faith in Blue, and they gladly accepted that invitation. Now, just so you know, in discussions about police work, I have somewhat of a bias. I'm a volunteer chaplain with the Bismarck Police Department, and I've had the privilege of getting to know and support quite a number of officers in all kinds of situations through things like death notifications and suicide and unattended death situations and ride-alongs. In the middle of some very difficult crises, chaplains like me are able to observe and sort of look behind the curtain. And I really am consistently so impressed with the quality of the officers and deputies that we have in law enforcement, the leadership we have in our region. I'm going to introduce you to a couple of these people in just a few minutes in the hopes you'll understand and support our law enforcement community more. But this morning emphasis, we're going to have a panel discussion, then I'll close with a message. But the panel and all we're doing is not just because someone came up with the idea of Faith in Blue. This is not a diversion from what we normally do here. It's a part of how God's Word instructs us to live. So, for example, in the very rich pages of the book of Romans, Christians are taught the necessity of submitting to governing authorities, those who enforce the laws of our society. Romans 13, verse 2 says this: anyone who rebels against authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and they will be punished for the authorities. And by the way, the Living Bible translates this word as police. For the police, the authorities, do not strike fear in people who are doing right, but in those who are doing wrong. So, if you don't want to be afraid, keep the laws and you will get along well. When you drive down Washington in the middle of the evening kind of thing, and it says 35 miles an hour, go 35 miles an hour. You won't have a problem, especially when you drive by my house, all right? The authorities, the police, are God's servants sent for your good. They're called to protect and to serve us. But if you are doing wrong, of course you should be afraid, for they have the power to punish you. Submit to them. Support. Honor them. Not only to avoid punishment, but also to keep a clear conscience. Or another translation says, just because you know you should. That's the word of the Lord. We shot a little video a week or so ago with Chief Dreyevich and Burley County Sheriff Lieben and Major Tom Iverson from the North Dakota Highway Patrol. And we basically asked them to talk about their relationship with the community and their work and what does that mean to them. So I want you to watch this video, and then I'll introduce you to a couple of our special guests. So just watch this.
Are members of this community. We live here. We have our kids going to school here. We shop in the stores.
Great pride in that, in being a part of the community, and that's exactly what we want, is for people to know that their officers are part of the community.
We go to our sons and daughters' sporting events. We attend church. We attend community events.
Their dads, their brothers, their sisters, uncles, aunties.
But also we have the responsibility to protect the community
who have been set aside by their calling to do incredible things for our community.
Not having community support would be a very difficult job if we didn't have the support of the community.
Following a national narrative of what's going on in law enforcement and knowing that we don't have to deal with that here is just like a big weight off your shoulders.
We are having members of the public walk into the courthouse to thank us. And I think that's something that we can never forget.
How do we say thank you for all the support that we get? And we really don't know how to do that.
It's kind of why a lot of us got into this profession, is because we believe in being a public servant and serving the public.
When we go out and interact with the community, that perception that they see is a good reminder to us of what we always have to be aware of.
When you're working the street, sometimes you forget that the vast majority of people are supportive of the police and want to have the police around.
The people's the best part of this community, and we hear that from our staff.
You know, you come across people, they thank you for the job that you do. It's definitely appreciated.
We're doing our best, and when our best isn't good enough, we'll do better the next time.
You don't know what that first responder is going into when you see that police car, fire truck, ambulance going to that call.
We don't know the people we're going to help, we just go.
You just never know what you're gonna come across. You could be doing traffic enforcement, you know, pulling people over for speeding or for other traffic violations, looking out for drunk drivers, or responding to calls for service.
I think underneath the armor and the bulletproof vest is people with a giving heart.
We are all in this together. We can't do this, we can't accomplish our mission without the support from our citizens.
When we make a mistake, we acknowledge it, learn from it, and move on.
It's people that truly get into this profession to help others. They don't do it for the money, they don't do it for the great hours, they do it because they care about the community they serve.
They're going to minister to somebody, they're going to help somebody, or they're going to protect somebody, and so let's pray for them. Pray for them, pray for the people that they're going to help, and pray for, you know, all down that system.
Well, I want to welcome and introduce you to a couple of wonderful people. First off, we have sort of right to kind of in the middle, the old guy.
The old guy.
Yeah. Dave Dreyevich, he's the chief of police for the Bismarck Police Department. He's been a police officer for 31 years, started up in Devil's Lake, then came to Bismarck, was a patrol officer. He did canine for a number of years, and then became deputy chief, and then chief for the last 2 years. He's a man of just very high integrity, a man of faith. He's a father and a grandfather, and he rides Harley-Davidson motorcycles, so he's the quality guy. And we're so glad to have him here. And next to him, the young guy, is Officer Tom Gross from the Bismarck Police. He's a father of three kids. You have three kids as well, Dave, just in case you didn't know that. You have three kids. And his father, by the way, was one of my teachers back in the day at Simley Middle School, so there's sort of a connection over the years. Tom started out as an officer with the Dickinson Police. In fact, you went to the same church as the Colings did back in Dickinson back in the day, and did that for about 11 years and joined BPD about 3.5 years ago. He's often on what I would say on the pointy end of the spear in the assignment that Tom has. He is a part of the West Dakota SWAT team. They get called out from time to time, and when they do, how often do you guys get called out?
Depends on the year. Sorry.
I was just talking to you.
Yeah.
Depends on the year, usually one and a half times a month.
Yeah, something like that. But his Monday to Friday job is part of the High Plains Fugitive Task Force. They serve warrants, and they go after some of the very most serious offenders in our area. And he's also a husband and a father, and he's a dog person, and we see him at the dog park. So, and he's a really, really nice guy. He really, really is, even though he looks a little nervous right now. So, and also here is Chaplain Greg Carr of Crisis Care Chaplains. He's a great friend of our church. He's been here numerous times, and he's going to participate in just a little bit and maybe add a little bit of input as we go along. But let me just put a little pressure on the two of you, especially as we begin. You're used to the rough and tumble world of police work, and there's oftentimes in doing so, you're around some pretty strong and salty language. That's kind of normal for you guys. I just want to let you know, if you swear or curse here, it will be a problem for me. And I don't want that to happen. So any curse words you use, even close to a curse word, will result in a $5 fine and 2 points against your eternal reward. So do you understand do you so stipulate that you participate? Okay, just making sure you know your rights, because, you know, it's going to happen. All right, let me start. Either one of you, what was your motivation to become a police officer? Why did you decide to do that?
Well, good morning, everybody. For me, it was all I had ever known. My dad was a police officer as well. And I grew up in watching the camaraderie that there is among law enforcement officers. And Tom's going to talk about this more, but it truly is going out and finding people that are doing harm in our community and arresting them for that and protecting our people that we for the community that we serve.
Yeah. Just leave your microphone on, okay?
So growing up,
what would you characterize, either one of you, the kind of the best part of the job?
For me, in my current position with the warrants that we have in the High Plains Fugitive Task Force, it's doing all the electronic surveillance, all the different types of surveillance and different means that we have to locate dangerous individuals. My main goal is, if there's somebody who's dangerous out there, I don't want a patrol officer to run across that individual in an alley somewhere, not knowing what he's getting into. I want
this kind of spread out a little bit more, what are some, do you find common misunderstandings about police work that you encounter?
I'll try that one. Sorry about that. People, it's hard to know what we do and the reasons that we have to do a lot of things that we do. We constantly research and read case law from what happens throughout the court systems to keep us knowledgeable about how we have to go about our business. And most people aren't doing that as citizens of the community. And so oftentimes we have to do things that they don't understand why we're doing them. And we need to do a better job sometimes at explaining that. But if people don't ask us, it's hard to answer those questions. And that's kind of why we're here today. So,
yeah. How are you?
I would say just the lack of understanding of what we deal with on a day-to-day basis and how quickly something can go from 0 to 60. You can start out an interaction, just introducing yourself nicely, and the next thing you know, you've got a fist in your face, and there's no chance to de-escalate that. Another thing is it's just the things that law enforcement officers will pick up on, either through training, experience, or just old war stories from your coworkers. Like, just something as little as asking somebody what their name is if they start with or repeating the question.
My name. You're saying my name.
What's your name? Every officer around that circle is getting ready to put handcuffs on her.
Yeah. You mentioned fight. When's the last time you were in a fight, Dave? Because you sit behind a desk most of the time right now.
Sadly, that's true.
Can we switch microphones and give Greg, can we do that to Carrie? I know Dave's microphone is acting a little funny, so.
Yes, Dad.
Hello. Keep trying.
Hello, there we go. So sadly, it's true. I spend the vast majority of my time behind a desk. But during the Dakota Access Pipeline protests that were around, we were at the last fight was at Kirkwood Ball on Black Friday, day after Thanksgiving. A group of the protesters from the camps down by Standing Rock decided they wanted to take over part of Kirkwood Mall. And of course, mall security did not want that to happen, and neither did the patrons or the stores of the mall. So, long story short, they went in there, started trying to take over the mall, started chanting, and mall security asked them to leave. They refused, and at that time, they became trespassers. Okay, they were not wanted. I think they had difficulty understanding the difference between public property and private property. The mall is private property open to the public. So the mall, they can decide when somebody can be there and when they can't. So when somebody's trespassing and they refuse to leave, that's when police get involved. And we started to arrest people and they didn't want to be arrested. So it really looked like a melee. I mean, there was 20, 30 officers there and hundreds of protesters. And it looked really, I mean, it was craziness. I had never been involved in anything like that. But the cool thing about the whole thing is the people that were in the mall surrounded us and started to protect us. And I had never seen anything like that in my career. And
Protect the officers.
They were protecting us as officers.
The general public did that.
The general public, all the people in the mall did that. They started hollering at the protesters, telling them to leave and never come back. And that seriously, that did happen. They never came back to Bismarck after that. And that I was so proud of our community and the people. I had never experienced anything like that. And it truly shows that the people, they are, you know, there's a saying that, you know, the police are the public and the public are the police. And that's true. And that happened that day and I got to witness that.
Yeah. And it's a... Now, your perspective on just to insert this, when we talked about this the other day, you don't you didn't dismiss the concerns of that were that existed in DAPL and your concerns for what happened on Standing Rock.
Yeah, well, certainly. You know, I feel sorry for the people of Standing Rock. They had, if I was living down in Standing Rock, I would not have been happy about that pipeline going through, if not knowing all the information. And I think their protest got hijacked. Those poor people down there had legitimate concerns, and people hijacked what they were trying, their message they were trying to put out. And we're constantly on making sure that we're trying to repair the damage that's been done because of those protests between law enforcement and the people of Standing Rock.
Yeah, yeah. Tom, you didn't have a fight this week, but you had another little incident this week. Can you tell us about that?
It was just one of those times I mentioned that it goes 0 to 60 really fast. I stepped out with a fugitive that was known for fleeing recklessly, and long story short, the next thing you know, he jumps in his car and rips the front of my police vehicle, and I'm trying to get out of the way. He hits my leg with his car on his way by, jumped a landscaping rock and clipped the marshal's vehicle, sped out of the parking lot, hit a patrol car on his way out. And he was fleeing into oncoming traffic on Century, extreme rates of speed over hills, and so we called it off. And like I was talking about earlier with the different means of surveillance, we ended up locating him the next day and denying him access to a vehicle and just arresting him after a quick foot pursuit. So
yeah, so that was on Wednesday.
On Wednesday, yeah.
Yeah. So I saw him Wednesday night or Thursday. We saw him at the dog park, and he said he got hit by a car. Well, when someone gets hit by a car, I'm assuming they're in a car. Oh, how much damage was it? No, you don't. I got hit by a car. So it was in his wife's, you know, she's hiding. She went, yeah, got hit by a car, kind of thing. So
I got hit by a car. I didn't get like run over or anything. So
oh, well then it's not a big deal. So, how you mentioned these split second decisions? How are our officers prepared for these split second decisions that have life altering consequences?
I teach the critical incident management course up at the Law Enforcement Training Academy, so it's kind of what I'm passionate about. When you're a brand new baby officer, you go through the 13 weeks of the training academy, and we tell you everything that we think you need to know. You learn all the laws, you learn some of the case law, and then in Bismarck anyway, you go through another 13 weeks of field training. That's where you're in the squad car with a more experienced officer, and you kind of learn what's going on the street, and that's where you pick up on the, you know, pausing after being asked a question and all the different cues that you come across. So you need to get the basic foundation of training done, but you need to continue that training. And what we do, Chief Dravich mentioned case law before. We always stay up to date on the case law that affects our district. We also watch the YouTube videos. We watch the things that come through the media of where officers either are alleged to have made mistakes or have made mistakes. And believe me, I don't want to repeat the mistake that another officer made on video. We use those as training guides for what not to do sometimes. And then there's also, we call them shoot, don't shoot scenarios, or they can be called if-then scenarios. I basically tell any recruit that I have, all you should be doing all day long is if-then scenarios or shoot, don't shoot scenarios. If I come around the corner and there's some guy with a gun over there, or if I pull up on this house for this theft call and the neighbor comes out with a knife, or you know, whatever the case may be, what are you going to do? Or if you're out of the car, are you going to be able to get cover behind that tree over there? Are you going to get in your car and retreat and set up a perimeter? What are you going to say on the radio? So by the time you do get into a critical incident, you've run through those situations in your mind hundreds or if not thousands of times. You can always tell the officers that have some experience and have been doing their scenarios and have prepared themselves mentally. We always laugh at the recruits that are in foot pursuits and it's nothing but incoherent screaming on the radio, where people that prepared themselves.
What's the first thing? All you hear is what on the radio?
Incoherent screaming.
Incoherent screaming.
Like
I heard, I don't hear what, I heard tinkling, and I didn't.
No, there's probably some of that, but yeah. You know, you'll just hear, he's running, and then nothing else.
Yeah.
Where a veteran officer or somebody who's prepared themselves for situations like that will be calling out very clearly directions of travel, landmarks, clothing description, et cetera, and they'll be able to impart that knowledge instead of just screaming, he's running.
Just to verify it, so I do ride-alongs with COVID thing. We didn't do them for quite a while, but Sergeant Berger asked me the other night to do a ride-along there. Just we want to be sure the morale of our officers is addressed by chaplain's contact. So I did my first ride-along for a while on Tuesday night. And we were talking about this the other day. There was a call. We were up around by Legacy. It was about 8 or 9 o'clock at night. There was a motorcycle going across people's lawn, something as innocent as that. And all of a sudden, a call came that a guy was being held at gunpoint over in Washington and high rate of speed across the city. And a guy was held at gunpoint, a drug dealer, known drug dealer, and he fled and is in backyards. And there's, I don't know how many police officers, were you there that night? I don't think you were there. But there were about 12, 15 vehicles, it seemed, from multiple agencies and police all over the place. And they immediately cordoned off the area. And they're going through backyards and canines involved and all that kind of stuff. It's a very dangerous situation, and they happen with some regularity. Not that Bismarck isn't a safe city, it is, but there's more going on than people realize, and these guys are at the front end of this all the time. Dave, let me ask you, what would you say how would you respond to this national call to defund the police that we keep on hearing about? This is the tough question.
Well, to me, it's craziness. It doesn't make any sense at all. And I feel sorry for the cities that are going through that. That has not happened here in Bismarck. We have not, of course, there could be a couple people saying that, but we have nothing but support from our community. We work very hard on that, to keep that support. We're as open and transparent as we possibly can be, and that's been working for us. The other thing that helps us a lot is we are an accredited agency. We've been accredited since 1991. And that's a lot of work. There are times I absolutely hate that accreditation because it is a lot of work, takes a lot of effort to get everything straightened out, but it saves us a lot of problems. It's really keeps us on the cutting edge of law enforcement.
What does it mean, accredited agency?
So there are certain standards that we have to meet, and next year we will be assessed. People will come in and look and make sure that we're doing the job that we're supposed to be doing in the manner of which we're supposed to be doing it. And it's a stressful time, but the last, I can't even remember, several accreditation processes we've gone through, we've achieved accreditation with a meritorious award, which is like the best you can get. And we want to always keep that. And one of the good things about it is we study things, trends, look for trends, and one of the big ones is that's being talked about today is race, or nationally is race, right? Relationships with the police. And we study that. We study our contacts with minority races and gender and look for patterns to see if we are treating a group more than we should be, if we're stopping people more than we should be, certain groups of people. And as we study that, we're able to look into problems if we have it before it becomes a problem. And I think that's what's really important about that.
That accreditation's not easy to get, right? I mean, not every department in the United States, in North Dakota even, have that accreditation.
Well, it's a voluntary thing. It's something we do voluntarily because we want to be the best, and I think we are the best. And you're right, there's only 3 accredited agencies in the state of North Dakota, us being one, Grand Forks the other. And the Highway Patrol beat us by a year. It's becoming the first accredited agency in the state. So.
Right. It doesn't mean if you're not accredited that you're not qualified to do police work, but it's sort of a standard that's been, as people kind of examine who you are, right? I want to come from the complicated, tense issues of things like defund the police and all that, get a little simpler. What are some of the common traits that you see among law enforcement officers and deputies and police officers and deputies in our area? What kind of things do people have in common, do you see?
Well, to me, the law enforcement officers I work with, and I've met a lot across our country and in our region here, they're all honorable. They all have high integrity. They have a servant attitude. They want to help their communities. I'm leaving the fun stuff for Tom to talk about. But these are the qualities of the people that we need to have. If they don't have those basic 3, they're not going to survive long as a police officer because you can't. They have to have those sorts of things.
Chief touched on the Type A personalities, and you see that a lot. Whether it's the obstacle course and the physical fitness test we have to take at the end of the year. If you're not number one, you're last. And so there's most of us will try to beat each other. If we're in the same room, we got to have the highest score on whatever it is we're doing. I think one of the common traits is just a deep level of caring, whether we let it be seen on the surface or not. Every one of us is out there trying to make a difference, especially in the critical incidents that we go to every once in a while, whether it be CPR on a child or just anything else that can shatter somebody's life. We all have a deep level of caring. And it adds up over the years, so a lot of people build defense mechanisms and they're unwilling to show that outwardly, but every last person I work with cares deeply about the community.
Yeah, when I've talked about this in public settings in the city at various events, and there's four traits, and these are the same four words I go to again and again after my opportunity to look behind the curtain and what I see in officers. And I did some of this in Detroit when I was there, and spend some time, but I'm seeing it so uniquely here among the officers, and it's a credit to the training they get, but also to the type of individual. And no one's perfect, and there's some real ornery guys, and there's some, but put the orneriness or the cynicalness or some of that inevitably arises. There's four traits that I describe all the time, and that there's courage, there's compassion, there's generosity, and there's kindness. And I see that again and again. Greg would agree as well. Those four: courage, compassion, generosity, and kindness. That is evidence in all kinds of ways. And I just admire, again, not perfect, but consistent. And it's a pretty good thing. Last question. I had people submit questions, and so I incorporated some of your questions into what we asked today. But the question that was asked a couple times when people suggested is how can we, how can churches, how can individuals assist and support law enforcement?
I would guess, like, in the current climate, and we all know that there's a silent majority of people that support law enforcement and law and order. In my mind, being a little less silent and more vocal, being the majority, giving law enforcement the benefit of the doubt. When you see that 2-second clip video that the media is showing you, there's a lot that goes into the events leading up to that incident and all the facts that led to that incident. So we see it time and time again when there's an uproar in the media about a certain situation or a death at the hands of the police, and the facts that are presented immediately by witnesses or loved ones, whether or not they believe those facts to be true, they're not always factual, and we see it time and time again when the investigation is over and all the facts are laid bare, that use of force or whatever happened in that video was 100% justified and legal. So if you get confronted with somebody talking about that type of video, you don't have to blindly support the police, but just maybe approach it with a little lens of critical thinking of what the officer might have been thinking at the time, or what the events leading up to that call may have been, the information that we don't know based off that short clip. So
yeah, force is generally applied when there's someone's in danger. Yeah. Dave, you want to add that? How the community can help, or what they can do to support?
Well, the one we missed, so Tom didn't bring up, I'll just say you can pray for us. We appreciate that, and we know you're doing that. But I can't really say much more than what he did. So what I always struggle with is, and I tell people this all the time, is I have never felt anything but support from the Bismarck citizens. And we're very thankful for that. And I struggle with how do we get that message back to the people that we are so thankful for that support. And it's not that we were talking about this on Friday. It's not like we're looking for stuff. That's not what this is about. It's
you're
just
not looking for cookies.
No. Yeah. It's nice when people do that, but
I'm looking for cookies.
But it's just so, everywhere we go, people are thanking me for my service or genuinely saying, what can we do to help, and wanting that service to help us as we serve our community. So that is appreciated. I just say thank you, because I know there's a lot of people watching too, and I guess that's the message that I'd like to get out. So. Oh yeah, this is a, and I'm surprised I didn't call him chaplain, but you know, thank you so much for letting Pastor serve as a chaplain for our department. It's very important for our people. There are a lot of people that rely on the chaplaincy, and it is so difficult sometimes to give news to people that is bad, and we don't know how to do it as police officers, and it is it's such a relief when we can call a chaplain to come with us, and they can stay with the people and make sure they have the care that they need afterwards. And so thank you for allowing that.
I'm very thankful for both of you and for the departments. And I know Sheriff Lieben couldn't be here today, but he is watching actually online right now. And so we thank him and all of our law enforcement partners really that we deal with on a daily basis as chaplains. The amount of integrity and courage that those men and women show is quite amazing. It says on your shoulder patches, it says, Bismarck Police, protect and serve. And our agencies are doing just that. We may not always agree with what we see and how we see it done, but there are processes that are in place that help clarify those situations from time. And we need to let those situations work themselves out and that process take care of itself. So we're very thankful for you guys, and we do pray for you. As a matter of fact, the chaplaincy has initiated the cards that are in your lobby right now, the posters in your lobby, the Lights and Sirens Initiative. When you see the lights and when you hear the sirens, don't think that you've got to go follow that police car, that fire truck, or that ambulance and find out what's going on. Say a prayer for those individuals. They're going to do something dangerous. They're going to do something that's life-changing. They could be going to help someone in trouble or deliver bad news or 100 different things that they could be doing. And so say a prayer for those officers and first responders when you see the lights and hear the sirens. And we're going to do that now. Pastor Brian asked me to pray for our law enforcement agencies. And so I would ask you just to stretch your hands out towards these two officers as they are representatives of all officers in our area, Bismarck and Burley County and the North Dakota Highway Patrol, Bureau of Criminal Investigation, even in Mandan and Morton County as well. So reach your hands out to them and join me in prayer as we pray for our officers. Father, thank you so much for the calling that you've placed upon our law enforcement officers in this area. God, you have given them very difficult jobs and callings. And we, Lord, want them to know how much we support them and appreciate what they do for us. But more importantly, God, we want to just ask you to protect them, to watch over them, to be with them physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. God, bless them in mighty ways. Be with their families, their husbands, their wives, their children, God. Be with them as well and protect them and watch over them. We thank you, God. Thank you for what they do for our communities. Thank you that they protect and serve. Thank you, God, that they run into the danger when we run away from it. And Lord, be with them and bless them in a mighty way. Again, God, thank you. Thank you for these two men for coming today and sharing this message. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's thank these two for joining us, okay? Thanks, guys. That was pretty cool. Thanks, everybody. Takeaways from this morning. An obvious takeaway is to pray, as has been mentioned, for law enforcement with the police and sheriff, the other first responders, fire and ambulance and so on, dispatchers, and they provide service and protection as Romans 13 talks about, and they deserve that prayer. It's a very important thing. And for a few minutes, I want to roll out, not long, it's not going to be a normal length of message, but I want to roll out one more fairly personal challenge for us to take into our weeks and into our lives. It's related to those virtues I mentioned a few moments ago that I see in our law enforcement personnel, the virtues of courage and compassion and kindness and generosity. those virtues, while they're awesome and important for law enforcement, are part of Jesus' challenge to all those who would follow him. They're for all of us. Police are not perfect examples of them, and they're not just a goal for cops. Jesus spoke of those virtues as central to how he wants us to live. For example, in the book of Luke, chapter 10, if you have your Bibles, you can turn there, describes an occasion when Jesus had sent out 70 of his most passionate followers to minister to people all around the surrounding area of Israel and to represent him and to interact with people, to bless and to encourage and to teach. One of the first missions trips ever commissioned was that one. And when the 70 returned, they had all kinds of stories about how God was at work through their meager human efforts. In Luke 10, 24, Jesus told them this. He said, "How privileged you are to see what you have seen. Many Old Testament prophets and kings longed to see what you've experienced, longed to hear what you hear, but they didn't. They longed to be instruments in the hands of God, which is what you've been able to do." It's an awesome thing. And right after that, a group of experts in Jewish law had something of a town hall meeting with Jesus after this had happened, and had kind of a Q&A session. And one of the guys stood up to test and question Jesus. And he said in Luke 10, 25, he said, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" In English, we assume that means, "What must I do to go to heaven when I die?" That's not what it meant. You know the language and the background, so it's more about what's God's kind of life? How can I reflect God's character? How can I find peace with God? And Jesus replied, "What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?" And the man answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." And right, Jesus told him, "Do this and you will live." And this is a man wanted to justify his actions as a way of living that out, and so he asked Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" In effect, he was also saying, "Where's the line between neighbor and not neighbor? Who can I exclude from feeling guilty about, right?" And Jesus replied with a story, a parable. This is one we all know. A Jewish man was traveling into Jerusalem, from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. He was describing a place they all knew about. This is a very real dangerous spot. The bandits stripped him of his clothes and beat him up and left him half dead beside the road. And by chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. And a temple assistant walked over, looked at him lying there. He also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along. Samaritans were a racially defined group of people who had been marginalized and despised and hated for generations. Those hearing the story would have heard the word Samaritan. They would have bristled. Oh, those guys. It says, when the Samaritan saw the man, he felt compassion for him. And going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, 2 days' wages, telling him, "Take care of this man. If the bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here." And that was Jesus' story. Then he made the point. He said, "Now, which of these three would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by the bandits?" Clearly it wasn't the priest or the guy who worked at the temple. And the lawyer said, "The one who showed mercy." He couldn't even say Samaritan. And Jesus said, "That's right. Now, go and do the same," he said. Be like him. Very famous story from Jesus. The dreaded Samaritan demonstrated willingness to comfort, to provide comfort and care for his fellow man. He showed compassion by stopping, by helping, by bandaging the wounds. Then he opened himself to danger by doing so, by stopping in a place where he could be set up for the same kind of thing. The Samaritan could have been beaten by the same bandits. He showed courage. The Samaritan also served a great personal cost. He put this man's needs in front of his own. He gave him his own animal, which means he had to walk the rest of the way. He took care of all the expenses. He showed generosity. And the most notable part of it all happened across a great ideological gap where hatred in dismissal would have been the norm. It was unadulterated kindness. There's a list of virtues again: compassion and courage and generosity and kindness. Jesus is inviting us to exclude no one from our love. He's very insistent that we should even love and serve our enemies in this generous and kind way. This excessive, this risky love that crosses social divides was uncommon in Jesus' day. It's not common in our day either. But even though it's rare, it's precisely Jesus' great hope, his expectation for those who follow him, that we frequently perform acts like this Samaritan, acts of courage and compassion and generosity and kindness that cross human divides. That's what Jesus calls us to, what he expects from us. And because of Jesus' insistence, it contributed to the establishment and growth of his church. According to both Christian and non-Christian accounts, one of the main catalysts for the church's explosive growth in the early years was the way Christians did this, as a small, tiny little subculture on the fringe of this huge Roman Empire. In fact, the early Christians' willingness to apply Jesus' teaching and behave as a Samaritan did made such a strong impression on Roman society that even irreligious Roman empires or emperors complained to pagan priests about their declining momentum, telling them to step up their game. Come on, guys, why can't you be more like the Christians? You might find this a bit relevant, but back in 249 to 262 AD, Western civilization was devastated by one of the deadliest pandemics in history. We don't know exactly what it was, of course, but the city of Rome was said to have lost an estimated 5,000 people a day at the height of this outbreak. And as the disease picked up speed and spread across the Roman territory, people were pushing sufferers away from them. They were throwing sick family members into the ditch before they died, hoping to avert the spread and contagion of this fatal disease. The worldly response to this pandemic was characterized by self-preservation. The Christian response, the church's response, was the opposite. According to a very famous historian, Dionysius, the plague served as a schooling, he said, a testing for Christians. And in a description of how the Christians responded to this plague, he described the amazing acts of care, churches pulling people from ditches, no PPE, of course. They took them home and cared for them. The historians describe how the best among them honorably served the sick until even if they caught themselves up in their own disease and costing their life as well. They were willing to do that if that's what it took. And in the era that followed the pandemic, the Roman Emperor Julian attempted to curb the growth of Christianity after the plague by leading a campaign to establish pagan charities that mirrored the work of Christians in his realm. And in a letter we still have that survived, Julian complained that his people needed to match the Christians in virtue, blaming the growth of Christianity on their benevolence to strangers during the pandemic, especially their care for the sick. And I love this line. The emperor wrote this, "For it is a disgrace that the impious Galileans, the Christians, supported not only their own poor, but ours as well." The impact of the virtues Christians demonstrated was twofold. Christians' sacrifice for their fellow believers stunned the unbelieving world as they witnessed communal love like they'd never seen before. And Christians sacrificing for non-Christians resulted in the early church experiencing exponential growth as non-Christian survivors who benefited from the care of their Christian neighbors converted to their faith en masse. Kindness and service and virtue has that effect. Generosity has that effect. I just want to wrap this up with one of the simplest personal illustrations I've ever given. And I can't believe I'm going to tell you this story because it might cost me in my home, Holly. But I've told you before that I get some of my best ideas in the shower, and I got this one this past week in the shower. It's kind of personal, but it came to me this week when I noticed a new bar of soap in my soap dish in the shower. We have two shelves in our shower. The top one is for Holly, and she's got various shampoos and conditioners and stuff, and she's got two bars of soap, one for her face apparently, and then one that's kind of a girly-scented shower soap. In my shelf, I have just two things. I have one shampoo and one very manly bar of soap. It smells, how can I describe it, kind of like a leather baseball glove and iron ore. I'm not sure what it is, but it's kind of a manly kind of a soap. And I've never admitted this to anyone, including my wife, but I have this simple little pleasure for me. It's watching for her to give me a new bar of my soap. As my bar gets smaller and smaller, it'll start to become this real thin sliver. And every time it happens, she eventually notices. And every time before the sliver fades away, a new bar just shows up. And I know it's weird. Maybe it's because of my love language is acts of service, but I love that she does that for me. And so I never do it for myself. That sliver gets small. I never fill it for myself. there are more important things she does for me and not, that I do for her. This is not the most important thing, but the soap thing is simple and small. But when a new fresh bar of soap shows up, it warms my heart that she's looking out for me. And I never ask her to do it. I never do it myself. In fact, I have no idea where we keep the soap. I have no idea where we keep the soap. Because I don't want to know. I just enjoy the fact that for 20 or 30 seconds some morning, the woman I love took care of me. Now, I tell you that and risk the fact that one of these days she's going to show me where she keeps the soap and expect me to do it myself. But I risk telling you about that soap deal to make this point. If one simple act of service, like getting me a fresh bar of soap, warms my heart, if I love this one simple act of kindness so much that I've enjoyed it over the years, imagine when you add to simple kindness things like courage and generosity and compassion. Imagine what will happen in our world when the parable of the Good Samaritan gets lived out in real life. I want my police friends to know these virtues can be so powerful as they serve in our community. Sometimes it won't be noticed or appreciated, but sometimes those virtues will be. And they can start altering the trajectory of a life. And for those of us who will never be cops, imagine what could happen when we infuse these God-inspired virtues with the power of God's Spirit in situations where there's a divinely directed appointment and you and I show up and serve someone with kindness and compassion and courage and generosity. It's how God changes the world. It had an impact in the year 262. It can have an impact in the very strange year of 2020. To watch for tiny slivers of soap that can be replaced by something we do to bless and encourage and help and bandage another. So watch for those moments. Pray for them. And imagine what could be. And if you ever doubt the power of those virtues, remember the impact Jesus' cross, Jesus' kindness, Jesus' courage and generosity and compassion, how they affect you. He's given those virtues to us, the benefit because of his grace. And from them, we find hope to go on and hope to endure. And if you look for opportunities, we get to go and do the same. And he will say there are prophets and kings who would have loved to experience what you can experience in this era, to be instruments in the hands of God. Would you stand with me for closing prayer? Heavenly Father, I want to add my prayer to what has already been said for our law enforcement people, our first responders, and those who serve us in such important ways. Bless them, protect them, keep our city strong and safe. But all of us have a role to play in that, not just to pray for those who serve, but to be one who serves. Give us capacity for those virtues to be true in us, in our relationships, in our homes, in our neighborhoods, on our streets. And I pray we'll see just a taste from time to time of the impact they can make on the lives of others. We're called to advance your cause. We're called to minister to the world and our world right now, our city right now, our neighborhoods, our families, the people we're near. We all need ministering. We all need hope. So help us to give just a taste by your direction. Bless us now as we go. Help us to see opportunities that you lay in front of us. We pray this in Christ's amazing name. Amen. God bless. See you next week.